the service this morning, I'll be reading from Luke chapter 24. This is from Luke chapter 24, and we read this. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified and on the third day rise?" And they remembered his words, and returning from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, and Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter rose and ran to the tomb. Stooping and looking in, he saw the linen clothes by themselves, and he went home marveling at what had happened. Let's pray. Oh, Father, we rejoice that you are risen. Lord, we are so grateful that in your love and concern for an unholy people, that you came in the form of Jesus, Lord, to live the life we should live, die the death that we deserve to die, and Lord, that you were resurrected, conquering death, hell, and the grave, our sins, our cares, our concerns. So, Lord, those of us that have tasted and seen the goodness of the gospel, have placed our faith in you, trusted in you, and have salvation, Lord, may that propel us to live as people who serve a risen King. Lord, rejoicing every day that we are safe and secure, not because of anything that we have done, but because of the perfect and complete work of Christ on the cross. Lord, for those among us this morning who may not have tasted and seen the goodness of the gospel, whose eyes may not have been open, we pray that everything that happens here this morning, from the reading of the scripture, the praying of prayers, the singing of songs, and Lord, most definitely through the proclamation of your word, may they be pointed to Christ Jesus, and would you lead them to faith and repentance in him. Lord, we pray these things for our good this morning, but ultimately we pray for your honor and glory, and we do so in the name of our Savior Jesus. Amen. Let's stand together this morning as we sing.
Thank you. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Isn't it a blessing that he is risen, and that's why we're here today? A couple of quick announcements. Youth group will resume on April 3rd, and communion is on Sunday, April 7th. And then the coffee fellowship is April 14th. So just want to make sure everybody's aware of that. There are a few more announcements in the bulletin, but please feel free to read through that. We could be here most of the afternoon if we went through everything. So, and that's a good thing. And just a reminder about the flowers. If you did purchase them, be sure to grab them on the way out today when you take them with you. So, all right, let's pray for the service. Dear gracious Lord, Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you for taking upon you the wrath of God and our sin, Lord, to pay that penalty. We praise you and thank you, and we can't say it enough. And most and more importantly, you rose again the third day as you promised. Lord, we thank you and praise you. We look forward to the rest of the service as we honor and glorify you. Give Pastor the word to say and speak through him. In your precious name, amen.
You can turn to hymn number 357. 357. We're going to sing Christ Arose. We'll sing all three of the verses before we sing the chorus this morning. Let's stand as we sing.
Thank you. Amen. Good morning, church, and Christ is risen. Glory to God. Children are dismissed. Is there children's church today?
Yes.
Yeah, children are dismissed for children's church. And they are excited to go. Okay. Well, as children are leaving for the basement to go to their children's church, if you have your bulletins, would you please open them? Just want to point out to you one quick thing. Like Brother Matt mentioned during announcements, there is a sheet of paper with the Easter flower in memory of your loved ones. And then there is a second insert. And as you know, last Sunday, we had our Sunday school teachers come up and share with us the amazing things that God is doing in their Sunday school classes as they teach the Word of God. And now I would like to take a minute or two and let you know that, Lord willing, as a church, starting next month, we will begin a new series of messages on the book of 1 Peter. I have entitled the series of messages, Hope Away from Home. And the idea is that many Christians today feel like outcasts in a hostile society that we live in. And the question that arises at the end of the day is, how can we navigate life in a society that seems to be increasingly opposed to our faith? Well, great news for us, and that great news comes from the scripture, from the Bible. The great news is that in the first century, Apostle Peter wrote a beautiful letter to believers who faced a similar situation, revealing to them then and revealing to us now how the gospel of Jesus Christ has the power to strengthen God's people in those times of adversity. So Lord willing, for the next few months till the end of the year, we will be in the book of 1 Peter studying the word of God together. We will be learning and be reminded of and encouraged by God's word about the promise of our glorious future with Christ, which sheds light on our present trials, empowering us to live faithfully as pilgrims as we are heading towards our heavenly home. Praise God for that. Amen. So we hope you can join us and be with us for the rest of the year and until God takes us home to worship the Lord together in this place, which we believe is a special place, and not necessarily because of any of us. It's because the presence of God is among us here Sunday after Sunday. And it's awesome as a church family to come together and corporately worship the Lord together. Okay? Please open your Bibles now for our passage for this morning, found in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 16, verses 1 to 8. When the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. And they were saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" And looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled back. It was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a white robe. And they were alarmed. And he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go and tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him just as he has told you." And they went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. This is the word of the Lord this morning. Amen. Let us pray, and then we'll dig into the passage. Father God, thank you again so much that you are who you say that you are. We thank you for revealing yourself to us through your word. We thank you for giving us Jesus. We thank you for the forgiveness of sins and the gift of eternal life that he came to accomplish on our behalf on Calvary's cross, and then on the third day as he rose from the grave, proving that the promises of God once again are yes and amen. And we are honored to be in this place to worship you, to sing praises to you. And I pray now, Lord, that as we open the scripture, that through the power of the Holy Spirit, you'll illuminate our minds and hearts, that you would speak to us, that we will be good listeners, Lord, that we will accept your word with gladness, that we will not let the worries of this world snatch the word that you have prepared for us in any way, that we will gladly receive it and do what you will be asking us to do. I pray now that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart, God, will be pleasing and acceptable unto you, my Lord, my God, and my Redeemer. Amen. Well, today we are celebrating one of the most important Christian holidays, and that is the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Cam, this thing is not moving on. I apologize. Can you get me going? Yeah. Thanks, man. Here was Cam thinking that he was going to sit down, and okay. So Today we are celebrating, as I said, one of the most important Christian holidays on our Christian calendar, and that is the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And I would like to remind you that Christianity, everything that we believe in, rests on this foundation, that Christ died and was resurrected. I want to briefly share with you some of my behind-the-scenes work as I sought the face of the Lord the last few days to illuminate my mind and heart so that I would know exactly what He wants us to hear this Easter Sunday morning. I'd like to share with you quickly how this sermon came about and the process that went into it until God allowed me to pick this passage. God basically brought to my mind that passage from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 3 and 4, in which Apostle Paul says this, "For I deliver to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ Jesus died for our sins in accordance with the Scripture, that He was buried, and that He was raised then on the third day in accordance with the Scripture." Brothers and sisters in Christ, what we have here in these two verses is basically the elements of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So for this Easter message that the Lord laid on my heart, that I'm about to share with you, I'm going to follow this outline. The outline that Paul gave us in these two verses, which are the elements of the gospel. So in the first part of my message, I want to share a little bit with you about Christ's sacrifice. Christ died for our sins. And then, Lord willing, after we tackle this first part of the message, that Christ died for our sins, I'll be sharing with you a little bit about the fact that Christ was buried. And then towards the end of my message, my plan is and my goal is for us to land on the last part of the message on the fact that Christ was raised on the third day. Okay? So to begin with, I would like to mention the fact that the resurrection of Jesus Christ, along with His crucifixion, is the central historical event in our Christian faith. Because at the end of the day, without the resurrection, there will be no Christianity. And Paul hits the nail on the head when he tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 14, when he said this, "If Christ had not been risen, then your preaching, people, is in vain, and your faith is useless, is futile. But glory to God that Christ did conquer the grave." So on this beautiful Easter Sunday morning, March 31st, 2024, we declare loud and clear for the glory of God that we are convinced that after dying a violent death on a Roman cross on a Friday afternoon in the year of 30 AD, Jesus of Nazareth, our Lord and Savior, the one who in the end every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that He is the Lord, He came back to life and emerged from the tomb on Sunday morning. And I am excited and looking forward along with you to dive into our passage for this morning, Mark chapter 16. But before we do so, as I said a couple of minutes ago, before we talk about the empty tomb, I really felt compelled in this message, the first half of the sermon, for us to talk about the agony of the cross. Let's talk about the suffering of Christ. Because brothers and sisters in Christ, the cross and the empty tomb cannot be separated. They go together. The crucifixion of Jesus Christ and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, I like to call them two sides of the same coin. So Good Friday, I would say, is only good because of Easter Sunday. And Easter Sunday is only possible because of the price that Christ paid on Calvary's cross on our behalf on that Good Friday. And Apostle Peter puts it so well in 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 18 and 19, when he said, knowing that you are not redeemed from your futile ways that you've inherited from your forefathers with perishable things such as silver or gold. No, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that, he says, of a lamb without blemish or without spot. So let's remember a bit. Let's take some time this morning and this Resurrection Sunday, and let's remember a bit about the cross. Let's reflect upon the cross. Let's think about the agony of the cross. So imagine with me that this weekend, it was Friday morning in Jerusalem. The year is 30 AD, Anno Domini. It is another hot day in the city of Jerusalem. It is killing time. Death is basically the subject of the day. Death is in the air. The word has spread on that particular day to every corner of the city that the Romans are planning to crucify someone today. A crowd gathers on the north end of town. Just outside the Damascus Gate, there is a hill. That place, we know from the scripture, was called the Skull. The Romans liked that place because that hill was beside the main road. That way, according to their philosophy and thinking, lots of people who were passing by could witness the crucifixions. By the way, it is estimated that about 30,000 crucifixions took place in ancient Rome. But the only one that changed the world is the crucifixion of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Glory be to his name. So on this particular day, more people than usual have gathered. A popular man in town named Jesus, they heard, is being crucified. The word spreads like wildfire. His reputation has preceded him. Some people believe his claims. Many doubted him. And a good number of people even hated him. The crucifixion, according to the scripture, begins at 9 o'clock sharp. By the way, the Romans were very strict and very punctual with things like that. Scripture tells us that there were three crosses on Calvary's hill on that particular morning. It appears that the man in the middle will not be lasting very long. According to the scripture, he had already been severely beaten. Luke 22, 63 and 64. He's been spit upon. Matthew 27, 30, Bible reference for that. He's been mocked. He's been stripped naked. His beard was plucked from his face, in exactly the same way and manner as Isaiah the prophet prophesied hundreds of years before this happened. And then we all know, brothers and sisters in Christ, what happened. Scripture tells us that eventually he was nailed to a cross. And let me also just say this, these truths don't even begin to scratch the surface of what Christ suffered that day. There are voices from all the three crosses all of a sudden that could be heard. Something that sounds like, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they do. Something else then about, if you are the Son of God, come down from that cross. Then a promise of heaven could be heard. Today, you will be with me in paradise. Finally, the scripture tells us that Jesus spots his mother near the cross and speaks to her, Woman, behold your son. Son, behold your mother. The scripture then tells us that something unusual happens that noon. Darkness fell upon all the land. Scripture tells us that it happened so suddenly that basically no one expected it. At one moment, the sun was right overhead. The next moment, the sun had completely disappeared. Let me also tell you this, it was not an eclipse. It was not even a dark cloud cover. It was complete, thick darkness. And it lasted for 3 hours. It started at noon. At noon, it was dark. 12:15 dark, 12:30 dark, 1 o'clock dark, 1:30 dark, 2:15 dark, 2:30 dark, 3 o'clock dark, boom, all of a sudden. Just as suddenly as the darkness had descended, so it disappeared. Scripture tells us that all of a sudden voices began shouting and could be heard once again. All the eyes are on the cross in the middle. It is clear that the end is near. Jesus is at the point of death. And then the word of God, brothers and sisters in Christ, tells us that suddenly Christ shouts, "Tetelestai," meaning it is finished. And by the way, for years, liberals and unbelievers and skeptics of the word of God have said that the cry of Jesus that day from the cross, "It is finished," tetelestai, was a cry of defeat. They say that these are the words of a man who had lost everything. Tell you what, this is not the cry of a defeated man. Instead, it is the shout of a conqueror. This is the triumphant cry of the one who had just won a major victory. When Jesus said, "It is finished," even though, my friends, he was physically weak, the Gospels tell us that he shouted with a loud voice, "It is finished." And I imagine that those words rang across Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth. The birds of the earth, of the air heard Jesus say, "It is finished." The beasts of the field heard Christ say, "It is finished." The fish of the sea heard Christ say, "It is finished." The veil of the temple heard Christ say, "It is finished." And the Bible says he was torn into two pieces. The ground beneath the feet of those Roman soldiers heard Christ say, "It is finished." And the scripture tells us that the earth shook beneath them. And those words thundered across the whole universe. I tell you what, when Jesus shouted that day, "It is finished," that was not a message of resignation. That was not a message of someone who was defeated. That was a triumphant proclamation. He was basically saying, "Father, I have come to accomplish what you have sent me to accomplish. And now the work is finished." In Greek, the verb is in perfect tense. It signifies a past action, the effect of which continues into the present. So it means it was finished, and it continues to stand finished and complete. Glory to God. So the question is, what was finished? And the answer from the scripture is very clear. The payment for our redemption was finished, was complete. And I love how Apostle Paul comes in Ephesians 1 and 7 and he says, "In him we have redemption, through his blood the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace." Now that's great news this Easter morning for me and you. Amen? That's the major part of the gospel. It is finished. And I have to tell you, this gives me so much joy on this Easter morning. It means that I don't have to work out for my salvation. It means that it is done. It's completed. The work has been accomplished. I love what the scripture says in Ephesians 2:8 and 9. It is by grace that you have been saved, people. Through faith, it is not of yourselves. It is not of your own doing. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no man should boast. My friends, Jesus finished the work on Calvary's cross, but the cross did not finish Jesus. Hallelujah. Let's go back to our verse. Remember, this is our outline. I delivered to you, Paul says, as of first importance, what I also received, that Christ died for our sins. We talked about this for a few minutes until now. Let's continue with the second point, and then Paul says, and then he was buried. So Scripture tells us that when Christ died on Calvary's cross, and we know this from the Bible as a whole, I am imagining the devil threw a party for his people, for his ambassadors, for his minions, right? The devil rejoiced. The devil basically thought that he had won. Christ is dead. He's a finished man, right? Scripture tells us that the people took Christ's body down from the cross. His limp, lifeless body was removed from the cross, and then his body was laid in a secured, sealed, and guarded tomb by the Roman soldiers. Notice, please, how in the Gospel of Mark, if you have your Bibles in front of you, right there, when Mark starts giving us the resurrection account in verse 1 in chapter 16, this is how he starts. He says, when the Sabbath had done what? Had passed. I want to point out to you that the other Gospels, Matthew, Luke, and John, do not mention the Sabbath in their resurrection accounts, right? But Mark gives us this account, right? And if we have any imagination at all, and I believe that we do, I think it will be easy to understand that that Saturday before the resurrection took place, oh boy, that must have been one of the darkest days in the lives of those disciples and followers of Jesus Christ that they had ever experienced. It had to be. I mean, what a dreary, interminable day that Saturday must have been for Christ's followers while Christ was buried, while Christ was in the tomb. I'm imagining that day to have been for them a day of shattered hopes, a day of broken dreams, a day of desolated spirits, a day of wounded and frightened and broken hearts, a dark and dreary day indeed, a day in which their future was grim and threatening. I mean, imagine that they had put all of their hopes in Christ. They traveled with him for 3.5 years, and all of a sudden, he's not around them anymore. All of their brightest hopes have collapsed around them. All of their choicest dreams had perished with the death of Jesus. Followers of Jesus Christ, I believe that weekend, that day, and that Saturday were crushed. Their hopes were dashed. Their dreams were demolished as they tried to live through that dark Saturday with no hope for the future, basically. Every act I'm imagining on that day must have been torture for them. With every fiber of their being, they were probably crying out to themselves and to the people around them, what's the use? Why move on? How can we continue life without our master? It was a day that they will probably have never forgotten as long as they lived. And you know, if we think about it, and we do, human beings around us, people who live around us in the society that we exist today, many of them live constantly in the despair and hopelessness symbolized by that Saturday. By the way, someone called our present generation Saturday's children. And I think it is a fit term for our generation. And you know, In our great American cities, for the most part, vast crowded pools of human misery could be seen all around us, where people live out their days in a kind of ritual dance towards death, without hope and without destiny. They are just like sheep, according to the gospel, like Jesus saw them and labeled them, like sheep without a shepherd. And yet the amazing thing about this account is that when that time came to record these events, when the proper hour arrived for these disciples to sit down and write their accounts, this dark day had dropped into the background, was so lost in the joy of resurrection. And the most they felt it necessary to say was only this: and when the Sabbath had passed, their hope was swallowed up from their despair. I deliver to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ Jesus died for our sins in accordance with the Scripture, that he was buried, obviously still in accordance with the Scripture. Then the last part of our outline is that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scripture. Let's talk about this. Would you please have your Bibles open, Mark chapter 16, we'll be reading verse 1 and 2. And then we'll dive into verse 3, because verse 3 is going to be the meat of this point, of this last point that the Lord wants to get across to us through me. Verse 1 says, when the Sabbath was past, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Salome, bought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun has risen, they went, Scripture tells us, to the tomb. Let's stop here for now with the reading. It is the picture that I would like us to get. Three devoted women go to the tomb on early Sunday morning. They go early in the morning before the sun rose. It is the first day of the week, and their mission was to anoint the body of Christ. The Scripture tells us that they realized that on their way to the tomb, they realized that there was a great barrier in their way. The Bible also tells us, and we know this from the gospel accounts, that the Jewish leaders basically went to Pilate and requested that a huge stone would be rolled in front of the tomb in such a manner that it sealed its entrance so that no one could enter the tomb or exit the tomb. So imagine these three ladies walking towards the tomb, and then all of a sudden it dawned on them, well, wait a minute, but who is going to roll away the stone for us? What I love about these women, and I know that I heard many great sermons, and in many sermons that I've heard, usually these ladies are put in a bad spot. I don't want us to judge them, and I don't want us to look at them in a very bad spot. And here is the thought that I want us to get from here. Man, I love these women, and I appreciate them. In spite of the fact that they knew there was a great barrier in front of them once they get to the tomb, that's what they thought they would find. Huge stone. By the way, scholars estimate that stone had to be at least 1,000 pounds. At least 1,000 pounds. In spite of the fact that they knew that they might encounter a barrier, they kept on going towards their destination. They kept on wanting to fulfill their mission. And they were saying, though, towards one another, who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb? Well, 2,000 years ago, prior to coming to Jesus to earth, a similar question was being asked. Scripture tells us that with the fall of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, man had been deeply in sin, separated from God, and the question that came up was this: who will break down the barrier between a holy God and sinful man? Who will make peace between God and man. And Scripture tells us that Jesus, the Lamb of God, said, "Father, here I am. Send me." Maybe some of you have been asking lately yourself a similar question that these ladies in the resurrection account have asked themselves on that Easter Sunday. Who is going to move the stone out of my way? When the bills are many and the funds are little, who is going to move the stone of my finances? When the relationship with so-and-so is not working, who is going to move the stone for me? And the questions can continue. I want to remind you, brother and sister in Christ and dear listener, that the same power that basically raised Jesus from the dead is available to change your life today and to move away any stone that you may feel right now that is blocking your view of the empty tomb. I'd like to remind you that fear is a stone that Satan has been using successfully for many years. Fear of the unknown, fear of rejection, being rejected by people, fear of being different, fear of failure, fear of surrendering your life to the Lord, fear of dying. What particular fear is blocking your view of the empty tomb this morning? Jesus is alive, and he has the power and authority to remove any fear that you may be experiencing at this moment. Apostle John says, "There is no fear in love, for perfect love does what? Drives out fear, casts out fear." God desires a relationship with us, and he offers us in return an eternity with him. You may have been rejected by society, but God loves you wherever you are at and whatever you may have done. Scripture tells us that we all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, but that's why Christ came to earth and died on Calvary's cross and rose from the grave, so that he can remove the barrier that's been between a holy God and sinful man and take that away. And he has the power to change your life. We do not have the power to change our lives, but God does, and he is an awesome God. Glory be to his name. So in conclusion, I would say that in some sense, the story of resurrection is very simple and very straightforward. It is remarkable, but it is also very clear. So here is, in conclusion, the story of resurrection. Number one, Christ came to earth as the eternal God-man. Amen? Number two, he lived the perfect life, unstained by sin and unable to sin because he was perfect in all ways. Number three, Scripture tells us that he died. And he died not because he was himself subject to death, but as a substitute to absorb God's wrath that needed to fall on me and you as sinners. Number four, he rose from the dead as an affirmation of his victory over sin and death. And number five, bottom line, in him and in him alone is all our hope. And the only remaining question is, do you believe this? And will you trust him with your life? There are people today who think that forgiveness of sin comes from their own self-effort, from their good works. And the Bible is clear. We quoted that verse earlier. No one righteous, not even one. Our righteousness is as filthy rags in our own power. Filthy rags, rags before a holy God. There is a problem with that theory. It's not what the Bible teaches. The message of Easter is this. Listen, please, loud and clear. That if you accept the gift that Jesus had already paid on Calvary's cross, and receive him as your personal Lord and Savior, you will be saved. Love it how John puts it in 1 John 5:11-12. He says, and this is the testimony that God has given us eternal life. And this life is in his Son. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son does not have life. My friends, the Easter Bunny will not tell you these things. He will not. But God does. Okay? So, again, to wrap things off and in conclusion, just a couple more lines, I would say that the empty tomb is the greatest source of joy for those who know Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. But it is also, and it will be also, the greatest source of judgment and condemnation for those who do not. So I encourage you, we beg you, with the choir, with the praise and worship team, with the deacon, everyone who is saved right now in this place and even listening online, that if you are not saved yet, if you have not trusted Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, this is the day. For those of us who are saved, remember we should not keep this message to ourselves. We have a mission. The angel then told the ladies, now go and tell that he has risen from the dead. We have to take this message home to our neighborhoods, to our schools, to our workplaces, and let everyone know that Jesus saves. So we would like to encourage you that if you do not have a home church, and if you are looking for a home church where to worship this risen Savior, come and join us here at the First Baptist Church. Remember when we had our business meeting, the last business meeting, someone said, and I don't remember exactly who, but someone said this, and that person was right on. She said, and I think it was Heidi, she said, yeah, we have a lot of people that we support as missionaries, you know, in other parts of the world, but we are also a missionary church, a church that reaches out into our community in many ways with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we do, don't we? So let's continue to do so. And may we say at the end of the day, like Joshua said hundreds of years ago, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you are indeed what you promised to be, a living Lord and a wonderful Savior. A God who is omnipotent, strong, powerful, compassionate, tender, merciful, gracious, enduring, and that you can enter our lives and begin to pick up all the threads of our despair and lead us back together and bring us out of darkness into your marvelous light, out of despair into hope, out of death into resurrection. Father God, we pray that many right now, in the quietness of their own hearts, may be praying to you, asking you to do what you promised to do in their lives, so that they also may be born into a living hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. We thank you, and we pray in Christ's name, the name that is above all names, and all God's people say, amen.
Please turn to hymn number 45. Hymn number 45, and let's stand together as we sing.
Thank you. Amen. He lives.
Thank you, choir. Wasn't this awesome?
Yeah.
Thank you, Gracious, for all the time you put into preparing our choir. It was awesome. Wasn't this a wonderful day since early morning till now? Praise the Lord. Would you please stand as we close with a benediction? What a great morning celebrating our risen Savior. I'm going to pronounce the benediction and then we will be dismissed. And now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, may he equip you with every good thing for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Christ Jesus, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. You are dismissed.